Douglas Haig is the most controversial British military commander of the 20th century, possibly of all time. And I think that a lot of nonsense has been written about him. He certainly made mistakes, mistakes which had some fairly bloody consequences, but he's by no means the pantomime villain that you read in some books.
On July 1st, 1916, Sir Douglas Haig etched his name into British military history after a weeks-long bombardment that saw 1.7 million shells fired. The General Haig followed up with the launch of an infamous attack against the German front line, which resulted in 60,000 British casualties and 20,000 declared dead after one day of battle. Some historians argue that Haig underestimated the German defences, or that he expected too much from the artillery. How would you describe the Battle of the Somme?
Well, they're both very big battles, of course, amongst the biggest battles in the history of the world. I think, if you think about the Somme, first of all, there were very good strategic reasons for fighting that battle, reasons that we often tend to forget today. And secondly, the second point I would make is that we tend to think of the first day of the Somme, which obviously was a bloody disaster in every sense of the word. But this was a battle that went on for another 4 months after that, and actually by the end managed to leave the German army in a pretty good mess, as things go. The Third Battle of Ypres, I think, is a little bit harder to explain, or at least it's easy to explain why it started. It's harder to explain why the generals carried on pushing for as long as they did in the conditions that they tried to keep on pushing in. They clearly felt a need to try and take the pressure off the French. They felt the need to take the pressure off the Russians. So again, there were good strategic reasons for having a go. But there were, I think, an awful lot of mistakes made in that particular campaign over the course of it that should really have been suspended a lot sooner.
Before the Great War, Field Marshal Douglas Haig studied and graduated from the Royal Military Academy as a cavalry officer, where he delivered 9 years of service before taking up the position of director at the Military Academy in 1906. From this position, he made his climb to commanding chief officer of the British Expeditionary Force, the BEF, in 1916, after it became clear that Sir John French was not fit for the task at hand. Haig's cavalry background has brought about much attention from many historians. He was seen to draw upon his previous experience from past battles and implement them into trench warfare tactics, especially when on the offensive. Despite new technology such as the tank and air force at his disposal, Haig still put his faith in both soldiers and the power of the horse to bring success. It has been argued that the launching of major attacks like the Somme and Passchendaele were a makeshift cavalry charge to try to break the deadlock and gain ground. The perspective of many was that he was stubborn and failed to gain the best of the new technologies available to him. Instead, he stuck to launching major attacks that cost thousands of lives with relatively little ground gained. Did this cavalry background have a major impact on the tactics he used?
I think Haig's cavalry background has been very overestimated as a factor influencing his conduct of operations on the Western Front. He was a very advanced cavalryman. In the aftermath of the Boer War, he was one of the principal proponents of the new form of cavalry doctrine, so-called hybrid cavalrymen, which had men riding into battle on horseback and then being able to dismount and fight as mounted infantry, but also carrying out traditional cavalry roles of the charge armed with sabre and lance, as the case may be. Frankly, I think that the way that he pursued his operations on the Western Front are not greatly influenced by his cavalry background, with one exception. Really, from the early 1915 onwards, he was looking to make a way of turning the initial break-in, which happened relatively often on the battlefront, so for example the first day of the Battle of Neuve-Chapelle in March 1915, into a more substantial break through and then break out. And he sought to use cavalry, mounted troops, in order to do this. But that's not, I think, to agree with the stereotype as a cavalryman who believed that only when masses of cavalry were deployed could the battle be properly completed. It's rather more in the lines of the advanced tactics that he was developing between the Boer War in 1914. And actually they have a distinct resemblance to some of the mobile warfare tactics used in the Second World War and after. The problem is, I think, if you describe someone as a cavalryman in a First World War context, it's a synonym for idiot. And actually that simply is unfair. It's certainly not true when in the case of Douglas Haig.
I think the importance of Haig's background as a cavalry officer is often overstated, I think, particularly by people who are critical of Haig. I think in reality, one has to remember that in terms of mobility, in terms of exploitation, and we are talking here about a period before the tank, or certainly before a tank. Second World War style, the tanks of 1916 were slow and liable to break down. So actually, in terms of mobility and exploitation, I think cavalry really is the only option. And I think Haig's attachment to the cavalry, it's not just because he's a cavalry officer. I think it's because he's also a pragmatist. And he realizes that this is the only way that any breakthrough is ever going to be exploited. With cavalry. Also, the numbers of cavalry troops available to him, that's often overstated. He's not got huge amounts of people milling around on horseback behind the lines. They do constitute only a small percentage of the BEF.
By the end of 1916, it was evident that Field Marshal Haig was clear about how this type of war was going to be determined. It would be on the side of who was successful in breaking not only the defences, but the morale of the opposing soldiers. And this could only be achieved by the grit and determination of those soldiers. The first day of the Somme saw major losses that were not anticipated by anyone, except Haig, who wrote in his diary before the battle commenced that the nations must be taught to bear losses. With the great losses incurred as a result of these major launches, many military historians believe the number of lives lost was not worth the little ground gained. In the case of Passchendaele, after the initial impact of the first launch, they failed to continue effectively, and Haig failed to grasp this. The continued push sent soldiers over the top without any real justification. Was this seemingly one-dimensional attack of launching major offensives really necessary?
Well, Haig really doesn't have any option but to launch major attacks, because if nothing else, the British are the junior partners in the coalition to the French, and the French want to clear the Germans off of their soil, quite understandably so. And so Haig, I think, is committed to a series of large-scale offensives, whether he wants to or not. Of course, he does want to, because he believes that that is the way to defeat the Germans, is to engage their main enemy, to grind them down, and eventually to force them to a position whereby mobile warfare can be regained. So I don't really think Haig can be criticised at that level. Where Haig can be criticised, I think, is that he sometimes pursued operations beyond the point at which they'd ceased to become effective, gone beyond the point of no return, in other words. And I think that he fails on occasions to grip his subordinate commanders. You don't find Haig pursuing the idea of the so-called tidy battlefield in the same way as you find Montgomery doing with the British Army in the next war. So I don't think that Haig in the end had much choice but to fight the sort of battles that he did fight, although clearly there is plenty of scope for criticism of the precise operations that he carried out.
The first day of the Battle of the Somme was, for General Haig and for Britain in general, an unprecedented military disaster. 60,000 wounded and 20,000 dead littered the battlefields. Haig's over-reliance on artillery had cost the British Army dearly. Historians generally agree that his over-reliance on artillery and his outdated colonial tactics had resulted only in a grinding stalemate in which both sides had pushed each other to no avail, resulting only in mass slaughter.
Oh, it was a terrible day. The lads led all of it. It was terrible to see them. They led like sheaves of corn in a harvest field. Terrible it was.
The whistles blew and our first line stood up and moved forward. Now, we'd been told not to run. We had to walk. And we must carry our rifles at a most ridiculous position up in the air. And yet suddenly I saw all our men lie down and I wondered if they'd got some further instructions. Then they didn't move and the second wave did the same and no movement. And it dawned on us then that they were all casualties.
In the years since the war, Haig's reputation has been mocked and criticised in television shows like Blackadder, showing his tactics to be outdated and callous towards the average soldier, leading one historian to describe his overall tactics as being that of lions led by donkeys. Do you agree with this?
I think in some cases, I think there are some donkeys, undoubtedly, but I don't think Haig actually is one of them, I suppose would be my point. And that the number of donkeys gets weeded out as the war goes on.
Unlike previous wars, the one that Sir Douglas Haig faced was unlike any other. This type of war was known as trench warfare, and the advantage was given to those who defended their side. In both the Somme and Passchendaele, the introduction of the machine gun brought about widespread criticism of Haig and his opinions towards new technology. Even though it was evidently clear that the chief commander of the British Expeditionary Force was an enthusiast for the power of artillery, many historians believe that he failed in getting the best from these new technologies.
The idea that Haig is a technophobe is quite simply untrue. He had a keen interest in technology and was very keen to use it. As far back as 1898, before he went to the Sudan, he went and had a look at use of machine guns because he wanted to make sure he knew how to use his weapons properly. He was a great proponent of the use of air power, of tanks. I think the one problem that Haig had is that he tended to be too enthusiastic about the use of new technology. So, for example, when he built his battle plan for the Battle of Loos in September 1915 around the release of chlorine gas, he was quite simply expecting too much of a first generation, rather temperamental weapon. Similarly, when he used tanks for the first time on the Somme in September 1916, I think he expected rather too much of what was still a fairly fragile and primitive weapon. So I simply do not agree that Haig was a technophobe. If anything, his problems with technology lay in the opposite direction of expecting too much of some, at the time, fairly rudimentary technology. But we shouldn't forget that it was under Haig's overall command the British Army embraced a style of war fighting, particularly 1917, 1918, which made highly effective use of the most modern cutting-edge technology.
On July 18, 1917, the Battle of Passchendaele commenced in a similar fashion to the Somme by launching a mass artillery bombardment that fired over 4 million shells in 10 days, immediately being followed by a mass infantry attack on July 31st. Initially, the attack seemed promising, but after the morning attacks, the Germans started to regain the land they initially lost. Many historians believe that this battle was the most controversial of Haig's career, in that it saw the loss of 310,000 soldiers in return for only a few kilometres of land. Can it be said that Field Marshal Haig did not learn from the mistakes that were made at the Somme?
I think they did take a lot of lessons from the Somme, and I think if you look at the way the BEF goes into action in 1917, July 1917, the Battle of Passchendaele starts, I think you can see that they've come a long way in the intervening period, the intervening year. If you look at things like artillery tactics, for example, you see massive developments there. That's a really obvious way in which things change. Nonetheless, I think Haig can be criticised, perhaps not so much at the tactical level, perhaps more at the operational or even strategic level. I think that's where you can criticise Haig for perhaps not applying a lot of the lessons he learned on the Battle of the Somme, expecting the breakthrough, which of course is the thing that Haig is often criticised for, and this is something which he perhaps he's guilty of doing that at Passchendaele as well, perhaps guilty of allowing the battle to run on too long, and thereby creating another Somme in a sense. So I think there are ways of criticising Haig, but again, I wouldn't want to overdo it because I think there are massive improvements in the intervening year between the Somme and Passchendaele.
Among all the controversy that surrounds the figure of Sir Douglas Haig, he did what others had previously failed to do. In beating the most advanced German army the world had ever seen, but at a great cost. After Sir John French was relieved of his duty in 1915, do you think there were any others that could have done the job better?
Well, there weren't many other alternatives at that point, that's for sure. And I don't think anyone else could have... I can't think who might have done the job better, let's put it like that. Of course, you never know. I think one could perhaps argue that he was a little small-minded sometimes in his dealing with the politicians. I think they were difficult people to deal with. Lloyd George, you know, is a match for one of the slipperiest men in British history. He'd be a match for most people. But I think, you know, one could perhaps argue that they could have found someone who was politically a little bit smoother than Haig. But overall, as I say, it was a small army before the war, and there weren't that many people of sufficient rank and seniority that could have potentially been in the frame. And therefore it's hard to see who else it might have been.
Wars are never pretty, and it's safe to say that World War I was one of the ugliest. But what is the measure of success in battle? Is it ground gained, number of enemy killed and captured, or is it winning the war with the fewest losses?
I can tell you what isn't a measure of success in terms of the First World War, and yet is the thing that's always held up as being the measure of success, and that of course is ground gained. The arithmetic of number of lives lost versus amount of ground gained, that's the thing that you always see for Battle of the Somme, for Passchendaele.
Victory. It's very straightforward, I think. forcing the enemy to submit to your will. And that's what I think Haig manages to do eventually.
Okay, the measure of success in battle, it is not always judged by gain of ground. That is the classic measure, and then towards the end of the war, in the 100 days from August, November 1918, it once again becomes a measure. It's at least in part down to attrition, not simply killing and disabling enemy troops, but also eroding their morale.
100 years on, the memory of the First World War remains ever present. Sir Douglas Haig was the man who took over the reins of the British Expeditionary Force at its lowest point in 1915 and took them to victory with grit and determination that was evidently shown by the courage of the British soldiers. The fallen and the victories will surely never be forgotten, and neither will the controversy that follows the image of Field Marshal Douglas Haig.